I was looking back on some of the past videos that I've made that we've done and noticed that I used the word Must just be a nervous tendency. I'm not used to being behind a camera and doing this, but I'm just gonna try to have the mindset of I'm talking to a friend and they're asking how things are going or have questions specific to type 1 diabetes and want to become more educated. So that's kind of my goal at this point. Let's talk today about honeymooning. What that is when your pancreas is still producing insulin after you've been diagnosed. So the doctors realize what's wrong, they know that this is what's happened and that you have type 1 diabetes because it's an autoimmune disease and the cells have attacked it and your pancreas is not going to be able to do its job. Then here's the little part that throws you even more for a loop. Your pancreas will produce some, and they call it the honeymoon stage until you kind of get past that. You don't know how much, you don't know when. So all the factors you figure out, your basal rates for what you need every hour for your child, your bolus rates for calculating the food, your correction factors, you get that all figured out and you do everything and then you go low or you go, and you're like, what happened? I did everything right. Like, I finally thought we had this figured out and things were going pretty smooth. Could be the honeymoon phase. So when that happens, you don't know how it's gonna play into it and it makes things a lot more difficult. So I remember even when that was happening at the time, and I never thought I would think that, but I'm like, I just wish the pancreas would stop because it's not gonna do its job. So if it can't full force go back to normal, which that's just not reality, then it needs to stop because it makes things so much more hard, so much more difficult than they already are. It's already, you know, you have anxiety and you worry about so many different things and you're trying so hard to make everything right. And then that can just throw you even more. But that's how this disease is anyway. Diabetes, it just kind of has a mind of its own. Sometimes I try to figure everything out and sometimes we can pinpoint, okay, we went high because it's time to change the pump and we're towards the end and it's just not working right. Or, you know, the pump isn't working because the cannula got bent and we have to change it early, unfortunately. And that's just heartbreaking and hard. Or whatever it is. So sometimes you can figure out what happened, or I took that and you know what, I miscalculated and I took too much insulin, so now I'm low. But when you figure everything out and then you still don't know what it is, you just kind of have to chalk it up to that's just diabetes. It's not perfect. So I know there were times when people would say they didn't really understand what was happening, but they just knew. I just had said her blood sugar went really high, we had to go to the ER, she was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, they put her in the pediatric, you know, intensive care unit, and she's, you know, we're home now and we're trying to like figure things out and adjust to this and figure out how her little body works because her ratios and factors and everything are so different than mine or my husband's because she's so little. Hers is hundreds and thousands for the amount that she needs compared to what we do. My husband and I have even, Drew and I have even said, like, we can't ever mix this up. We can't ever accidentally dose her for ours because it would, you know, be the end of it. It would just not Mommy. Work because she doesn't need that much. I'm gonna say hi. So anyway, I forgot what I was saying. But the honeymoon phase can be hard. So there's just a lot to it. So I just want parents out there to know, like, you know, you're doing the best you can and just keep trying and it's okay. But what I was gonna say was when people would say, so do you have her blood sugars regulated now? Because they knew that, like, you know, they had elevated and shouldn't have. And I wanted to be like, we're good for the hour. Like, talk to me in an hour. Bless you. And we'll see where we're at because diabetes isn't like that. You can't go, okay, my blood sugar is good now. Like, everything's fine. It doesn't work that way. But it's just a constant continuation of trying to figure it out and trying to keep it regulated and have your target range, which is 110.
Go, go, go.
So anywhere in the safe zone. If you're 80 to like 120, that's great. But for the tandem pump, the algorithm that it uses is, your target is 110. So when we had Ellery on injections still before we were on the pumps, it was really hard to keep her leveled even more. And the diabetes educators and the pediatric endocrinologist, they all wanted her higher in the evening because you don't want them to go low when they're sleeping. If she's at 200 or 220, that's okay. But once we got her on the pump, we were able to get her down to like that 110. And we have hard nights at times and things are scary and the Dexcom will be beeping and we'll do a finger poke and she will be low. And whenever she's low, we always check it because you don't want to treat it if for some reason it was off and she really is okay. And then you treat it, she could end up high. But you also don't want, if it says she's high, you don't want to give her a correction, because if it's incorrect and she was okay, it could make her go a lot lower. So having a continuous glucose monitor is incredible and I am so thankful for it. And I can't imagine without it. Even when we have our 2-hour warm up, we're like, oh, we can't wait for it to be back up, because it's so just a relief to know that you have that. And there's a 20% variance. So if it's off slightly, it's okay. And you can calibrate it, but it works really well. We can kind of get into Dexcom and the different tips and tricks that we've learned about it that help with it. It's hard when there's sensor fails, because that happens more often than not. And it's a bummer when I'm hoping for 10 days and we don't get 10 days out of it, or it's just giving like super wonky readings and just out of control and it won't be on track. Then we have to change it. It's just not in a good spot, or something's wrong with the wire. It's not working well. So, but having the pump, being able to keep her regulated, her nights are usually like 90, 100 and she will just float there. And it is the most wonderful thing. It also has a sleep option. So you can put in like sleep or activity, and you can set settings for time so that when they're sleeping, the pump is going to behave differently than when they're awake. When they're doing exercise and activity, the pump is going to behave differently than when they're not. So that it takes into account all of that. And it knows like, okay, if they're exercising more, even if it's kind of going up right now, they're going to be exercising. I'm not going to give them a bigger correction because the exercise could bring it down on its own. So we're going to watch it and see what she needs when, kind of back off. And same thing during the night. You don't want to go low. You don't want to stack insulin. You don't want to give too much insulin. So those are all really nice things to have with it. But back to the honeymoon phase. So that's just one of those hard things. And it's really hard that you never know when the tail end of it is. You don't know how long that your pancreas is going to keep producing insulin. And it doesn't do its job all the time, but it doesn't quit either. So it's kind of sporadic. And it just makes things more complicated is all. So that's kind of in a nutshell what honeymoon phasing is, if anyone was curious. Bye for now.